but I want to talk about God's eternal purpose. And I have to tell the church this morning, I by no means know all that is entailed in his eternal purpose. We are only given a facsimile. We see through light, a dark, yeah. We only see a portion of it, don't we? But I can tell you this of a truth, since my childhood, I have seen more of it. Yes. And I think the longer we live, the more we will see of the mysteries of God. But I don't like to take those mysteries apart unless they're totally revealed, because they become man's idea and not God's. So I just want to impart to you a few things that the Lord spoke to my heart this week concerning God's eternal purpose, because sometimes, I don't know about you, but I just kind of look at my life day by day and I think, oh, this is Saturday again. This is Tuesday again. I got to do this. I got to do that. And then tomorrow is Sunday, you know, and you just sort of get caught up in the routine and you lose the eternal purpose, which is why God created us. He had an eternal purpose in mind. So the message today comes out in Numbers chapter 14. And this has to do with Moses, and I'm sure that every one of you knows this account of Moses when he stands in the gap to the Israelites. God was going to send the 12 spies in to spy out the land, and God told them what to do and where to go and how to do it. And God said, I'll be with you, I'll give you the land. And everyone knows that the spies went in and there was disobedience there. And God was angry. So I guess there's a righteous anger when we get angry at sin and we say, I hate the devil. You know, there's a righteousness in wanting to not give homage to the wickedness and the evil that's in our earth today. But God was angry with their disobedience and with their sin. And he said, I'm just going to get rid of them. And we thank God for Moses, because Moses talked to God about his reputation. Moses didn't necessarily stand in the gap for the people. He stood in the gap for the reputation of God. He said, what will the other nations say if you do that to your chosen people? And so what a message that we see in this passage of Scripture. So the spies were sent out, you know, they found the descendants of Anak in this 11th chapter of Numbers. And Anak's descendants were giants in the land. And there was a great tribe of these giants that were in the land that God sent them to spy out. And so when they came to spy out the land, they felt like grasshoppers. Did you ever feel just tiny and insignificant in the plan of God? And sometimes you look around and not only do we feel insignificant in the plan of God, but when I see a church of 5,000, I feel a little grasshopper-ish. If there's such a word. You know what I'm talking about? When you see things that are bigger than you, that are sometimes more important than you. You know, we don't evaluate things like God does. Sometimes God thinks that little things are just as important as the big things. But they felt like grasshoppers, and they spied out the land, they saw everything good, but when they saw the giants, fear overrode the presence of God and his promise to them and what he would do for them. He said he would give the land to the children of Israel. Well, you know, God has promised to give us things, but we got to go through trials, we got to go through temptations. We got to go through these things and be aggressive against the things of the enemy, that we might produce the things that God has for us. And so they spied out the land. They found a bounty of fruits. You know, we see that picture of them carrying the grapes on a big limb, you know, huge grapes and pomegranates and all the glorious things that was in this land that God was going to give to them. And God has got a land for us that's promised, and God's got good things in that land. And we're spying out the kingdom now, and we're doing the work of the kingdom that God has called us to, we hope. But fear overwhelmed them, and they didn't discern God's purpose. And that's what this message is about today, that we discern the purpose of God. What is the purpose of God? Now, before we get into asking him, what's the purpose of my life? You know, what's the purpose of my ministry and that? Let's just hear the basic truth of what the purpose of God is. And the purpose of God, sometimes we don't discern his purpose in our trial or in our tribulation or in our heartache or our sorrow or our lack. We don't understand all that God is purposing to do in our life. And sometimes fear overwhelms us. Now, as Christians, we don't think about that. We don't think, you know, when something comes upon us and we start wondering, why is this happening? We don't really think, oh, I'm full of fear. But it is fear because we are concerned and we worry. And God wants us to know that he has given us a promise. And he said, I'm never going to leave you nor forsake you. And am I only cattle on 1,000 hills? And we got to know the word of God and quote it to him. And then we have to stand fast until we see his glory revealed in us. So God brought us into this world. He gave us the Holy Spirit. He gives us the knowledge of his word. The problem that we have in Christianity today is that people don't partake of the knowledge of God. The knowledge of God is in his word. And so often there's multitudes that just go to church to get that little snippet of knowledge, and they never understand the totality of God, because you have to find that for yourself. And the reason why I say that is because the Bible tells us to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. So we have pastors, and we have teachers, and we have apostles, and we have missionaries, and we have all these people to inspire us. But when it's all said and done, the eternal purpose of God is that we search for him with all of our heart, and we love him with a great devotion. So sometimes we learn in this account that our faith is often tempted. I don't like to think about that, but it's true. Our faith is tempted. You know, God told the Israelites, I brought you through all of this, and if you know all the troubles that the Israelites had, he said, I did it to see if you would be faithful and if you would follow me. And our trials and our temptations and the negative things that happens to us is to see, to be able to prove our love for God and to stand fast in those things that the enemy puts against us. So the eternal purpose of God, we see in the commission that Jesus said. He said, you know, go into all the world, preach the gospel, you know, and do what I've called you to do. That is enlarge the kingdom of God. And so as we learn in this account of scripture, the 12 spies, their faith was tested, because when they got there and they saw the giants, they go, there's no way we can do this. Did you ever have a trial or a temptation that loomed at you and you're thinking, no way can I get through this, you know? You know, as we see prices raise, I went to the grocery store last week for the first time in a long time, and I go like, what happened? You know, the prices are so bad. And, you know, you just sort of stand there and you remember when you used to go get bread as a child, it was 20 cents, you know, and now it's, you know, $2 or $3 if you get the kind you want, you know. But everything changes, and it's all producing our faith, you know. Can we make it through this? You know, and it seems that the prices go up, but the salaries don't usually go up. And if Social Security goes up, then everything else that you need in Social Security goes up. So our trust and our hope has got to be in God, and we cannot fear those things that come down the tube towards us. And Joshua and Caleb were the only two out of the 12 that had the faith to stand up against this. And I love Caleb's response in Numbers 14, 7 and 8. He spake in front of all of the company of Israel. Now, this is not a small thing, church. There was millions, hundreds. And he got up in the front of them, and he was, you know, everybody was saying, 10 of them was saying, we can't do this. Have you seen it? These giants are huge. We were like grasshoppers, blah, 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 blah. You know how we get. They were just carrying on, and Caleb stood up in the midst of all of this, and he spake to the whole company of the children of Israel, and he said, the land which we passed through to search, it's an exceedingly good land. Verse 8, If the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it us, a land which floweth with milk and honey. So out of all of this, there was one man, two men, Joshua stood with them, that they were well able to do what God asked them to do. You know, sometimes, church, the longer we live, the more difficult things become. We have to have a spirit of Caleb in us that we are well able to do this. It's interesting that David caught this message in Psalm 37. He said, and I know you're familiar with this psalm, he said, delight thyself in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Well, you can't just delight, but you also have to commit. The word of God says, commit thy way unto the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. In this Lenten season, this is what we want to do, is we want to delight ourselves in the Lord. We don't have to do this. It's not written, thou shalt do Lent, you know, but it's a time that we set apart to honor what Jesus Christ has done for us. It's a simple thing that we ask of the body of Christ to do in honoring the Lord, to delight ourselves in him, to say, I give this up to you. This is precious to me. I like this, and I'm going to give it up, and I'm going to discipline myself, and I'm going to take on something spiritual. You know, it's no good to just give up something because you'll just take up another habit, you know. But it's good to give up something and take on something spiritual that you might delight yourself in the Lord. Now, I want to tell you that God's delight is in his people. He rewarded Joshua and Caleb for their trust and belief in him. Later on, when Joshua and Caleb was old, he gave Joshua leadership of the tribes of Israel. He gave Caleb the mountain that he wanted, and he rewarded them, but not in the moment that they did it. We go through our trials and temptations, and we think, okay, now I did it. God, give me something. No, you might have to live a long time in your life to come to the end of what God has for you. Our world is filled with opportunities to distrust. It's filled with opportunities to be tempted. And I think that Christianity at large has a seared conscience because evil is so prevalent and it's so hard to escape it. It's everywhere. You know, it's all around us. You just have to be doing this all the time, turning your head, because evil is so prevalent. And the Church of Jesus Christ at large has taken on the effect of, well, what can we do to get the people in? We do things like the world to get them in, but we never, ever tell them that it's a saved and sanctified and purified and a holy life, and we cannot be the same when we come to Christ. We have to be what? A new creature in Christ. And so this season comes upon us to give an opportunity for us to look in the mirror and say, I want to remember that I'm a new creature in Christ. I want to, you know, reverberate who I am in Christ. I want to, you know, clean up the house and make it perfect for the presence of Christ to live in. The purpose of God is exceedingly more large and more powerful than I can even equate today. But God's eternal purpose, church, is you. His eternal purpose is us, is his people. That's why it all came about. The eternal purpose of God was that Christ would die, that we could have salvation. I cannot reiterate it enough that you would not want to live by the law. They could not fulfill the law. People look over there and they say, well, the Israelites, they just kept failing because they could not be obedient to the law. And that's why Christ, in his eternal purpose that God proposed, he gave his life that we could have such grace and such mercy as we have today. Israelites didn't have mercy. You know, when they failed, they just got blown away. And at that simple moment, when God stood before Israel and wanted to annihilate them because they could not keep the law, someone stood in the gap. And God's eternal purpose is that we, his people, will stand in the gap for Christianity today, that we will stand in the gap for the kingdom of God, that we will not be like the world, but we will be consecrated and sanctified and set apart. Does that mean we can't have any fun? We can't have recreation? What does that mean? Do we have to wear our hair up? What does that mean? That means we have to emulate Christ, His love, His joy, His peace, His long-suffering. That's the things that we have to emulate in the inside. Because if we have the inside right, it will come forth on the outside. So the eternal purpose of God, if you don't remember anything else, when somebody says, what did she preach? You say, the eternal purpose of God. And now we know what it is. It's me. It's you. God did all that He did for us, for His people. The Lenten season, which is upon us now, is to commemorate God's sacrifice, gave His Son. Christ's sacrifice, gave His life. I know I'm preaching to the choir. I know you know this. But every once in a while, we have to just stop quietly and stand before God and take, what do they do in the stores when they take
inventory.
We have to take inventory. Where are we spiritually? Where are we going? Oh, yes, I read four scriptures a day. No, we need to read four chapters. You know, well, I pray every morning for 10 minutes. No, morning, noon, and night. You know, and an attitude of prayer as we go our way, an attitude of thanksgiving. Now, Paul had an enormous meeting with Jesus. And I hope that somewhere in our salvation that we've had such a meeting with Christ, that He has come in and He has had, you know, this moment that has changed our life. Because if it doesn't happen, then we don't ever become the Christ, the servant of Christ that He wants us to be. And I know that you know this story of Paul when he met God, Jesus on the road to Emmaus. Well, in Acts 26, it was about midday, and it says that a light came from heaven, and it was as the brightness of the sun, and it shone about Paul, and it caused him to fall to the earth, and he became blind. And a voice spoke to him, and Paul questioned, who was speaking to me? It'd be really wonderful, church, in our trials and tribulations, when we start to hear voices, that we would say, who is it that's speaking to me? Is it you, Jesus? You know, or is it that voice of fear and doubt and anxiety? Sometimes we need to be blinded by the light of Christ until all that we see is Him in the midst of our crisis. And Paul was blinded physically, and he questioned. And in verse 15, he says, who art thou, Lord? He knew there was a higher power. He didn't know Jesus, but he knew there was a higher power. Now, let me tell you something. This earth knows there's a higher power. They'll talk about a higher power if they don't want to say God. And if they don't want to say they believe in Him, they want to say, well, there's a higher power. Because they know something is greater than they are. And Paul knew that. Paul, since this must be something more powerful than me if it can knock me to the ground. And so he said, you know, who art thou, Lord? And the scripture says that Jesus answered, and he said, I'm Jesus, whom thou persecutest. We might hear that sometime when we say, Lord, you know, what is happening in my life? Who is speaking to me? Because if we're listening to the wrong voices, then we're persecuting the Lord Jesus. And Jesus said to him, rise and stand upon your feet. For I have appeared unto thee this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of these things which thou hast seen and of those things in the which I will appear unto thee. This is the great commission, you know, the eternal purpose of God, that we will be a witness. We cannot be a witness if we haven't partaken of His holy salvation. This is our purpose, church. For years as a child, I sat in the church, we had prayer requests. And we'd go around the church and people would say, pray for the will of God in my life. Pray I find His purpose. I wish somebody would have got up and said, I know your purpose. Your purpose is to be a witness of Jesus. Your purpose is to tell him what he's done for you. If I said to the church today, everyone stand up and tell me what God has done for you. You know, he's done so much, you'd have to stop and think a minute. You know, you'd have to think. Think when he brought you through the circumstances of your life. Think when he brought you through the crisis that you've been through. Everybody's been through these things. Been through brokenness. Been through heartache. Been through lack. The older folks like myself, we all talk about how we was raised and how we did had so little. And we did so much. I was talking to Toy the other day. I said, we need to go somewhere exotic. She goes, well, if I had money. And I had to remind her that we have gone all over the world with nothing. You know, we've been to Israel. I've been in 27 nations of this world. And I've never, to this day, this is the day that I get good pay, thank you very much. But before this day, I lived on faith, total faith. I didn't know I was living on faith, I just was doing it. You know, because when we have to say we're living on faith, then maybe we need a little more the Holy Ghost to help us. But you know, if you look back at your life and you see the way that you were raised and as a child and the things that you did not have, and the lack that was in your life, and especially if you was in a Christian family, you know that that your parents prayed you through. You know, we went to go to the doctors. I tell this story all the time, and I said, Mama, what will we eat? Because you have to take 4 buses to get from where we were to the doctor. And what will we eat? It's going to get noon. Oh, we'll just pray. God will provide. You know, on about the 3rd change of buses, there was a sack sitting on the bench. I've told this so often, but I can't help it. I have to tell it one more time. The sack was sitting on the bus stop bench. I opened the sack, 2 sandwiches, 2 cakes, 2 apples. This happened. And I said, oh, my mama said, first let me pray over it. You know, we sat there on the bench and my mama prayed over it. Over and over and over in my life, I saw the provision of God. Because it's his purpose to help his children. Because we're his purpose. That's his eternal purpose, that we can live this life with him, with hope, with grace, with mercy, and know that there's a life after this. You know, Sandy today is in that life.
Yes.
Oh, they're still having all the problems of taking care of this temple, but the temple of God is already there. She's already there worshiping God. Because the purpose, the eternal purpose of God, is that's where we'll end up. That we will have these things and he will walk with us. So Jesus said, rise and stand on your feet. I heard him say that to me this week as I was studying. You know, when you get in the molly grubs and you get all these things coming at you, and this is the word of the Lord. Stand on your feet, you know, because the Lord Jesus is for you, and no weapon that's formed against you will prosper. And Jesus said to Paul, I'm coming to you with purpose. And the purpose is to give you light and life eternal. And to make you a minister, somebody said, well, we have a minister. No, you're a minister. I'm just the preacher. We're all ministers of the kingdom of God. Jesus said to the commission, go. He said to all of them, go and preach the gospel. You can preach it by living it. You can preach it by facing your struggles in faith. It's how we handle our struggles that defines our faith. That is a profound statement. It's how we handle our struggles that defines our faith. And so Jesus said, you know, I appeared unto you with purpose to make you a minister and a witness. And here's what we're supposed to do, church. I wish they would have told us when we were young these things. You know, but what we're supposed to do is just witness about what God has done for us. If you've gone through a divorce and you see somebody going through it, say, let me talk to you about this. There's life on the other side of it. God will walk with you through it. You're not condemned. You don't have a red scarlet letter. He's with you. He loves you. He forgives you. You're whole. You know, if you're going through financial failure and you have to do whatever it is that you do, what is it that they do? Bankruptcy. And then you go around hanging your head. No, no, no. He brought you through. You're in your right mind. You're clothed. You got, you know, roof over your head and wheels on underneath you. You're all right. God brought you through. He brings us through. We like to just get out of it. We just like to go, you know, around it. We don't want to go through it. But the purpose is that we go through it and we see His hand bringing us through those difficult seasons in our life. So this is the Great Commission, the eternal purpose of God, that we'll be a witness of what He's brought us through and what we will see happen on a daily basis. You know, it says we must think of delighting in the Lord. We must be as Caleb. The Spirit of God welled up in him. And Caleb, the people was fussing and carrying on. And the Bible says that he stilled the people in front of Moses. And he said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome. That's how we should handle our struggles. Let us possess the Word of God. Let us possess our faith. Let us possess the grace and the mercy that God has given to us. We hear His Word as He discloses His eternal purpose. Ephesians 1. And if you have your Bibles, just turn there because I would like for you to see this. This is the eternal purposes of God. He has chosen us in Him before the foundation of the world. If anybody studied the Word, you know in Psalm 139, He says He knew us before we were born. And here it says He has chosen us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before Him in love. See, what God desires of His people is that we love Him. That we love Him. We don't have to do exploits. We don't have to wonder what will our ministry be or what will my life be. It's just love Him. Love Him with our whole heart. You know the passage of Scripture. Verse 9, it is His good pleasure. God takes pleasure in us. It is His good pleasure that He has purposed in Himself. I love this because He spoke to Himself. You know, over there in Psalms, it also says, speak to yourselves in hymns and songs and spiritual utterances. You familiar with that passage of Scripture? Now here we see that God speaks to Himself. And He speaks to Himself and He says, you know, I'm going to have good pleasure in them. I don't see their sin. I don't see their wickedness because somebody stood in the gap for us and it was Jesus Christ. And He would see our sin unless it be for Jesus. Jesus stood in the gap for us even as Moses did that day. Verse 10 says that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, we're getting there, church, that He might gather together in one all things in Christ, both that are in heaven and earth, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of Him who worketh all things after the counsel of His will. It is wonderful to study in your Word the purpose of God. That passage of Scripture itself will preach, you know, He purposed it in Himself. God's eternal desire is to gather everything in heaven and earth together. So, as we're ready, are we ready? Is the church ready to be gathered together to receive the inheritance of God? The Lenten season is about this. It's to bring us to a quiet halt that we might think on spiritual matters. God's eternal purpose is by grace through Christ who stood in the gap for us. And the Scripture says in Ephesians 3:10, this is God's intention. Verse 10, Ephesians 3:10. This is God's intention, that under principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God. According to what? The eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. You know, we have boldness, access with confidence in him by the faith of him. Amen. So the eternal purpose is to gather us unto himself. And until the moment that he gathers us unto himself, we're supposed to be a witness of his glory and his service. The church at large, this is the question. Does the church of Jesus Christ at large have eternity on its mind? I think what it has on its mind is not much of eternity. Because we're building like we're going to live forever. Serious. You know, eternity on our mind. That will help us in our struggles. It's something that the brother that just passed away, Kim Starner's husband, died. They said some quips that he used to say. He was quite a colorful person. And he said things, all this stuff is just things that's going to burn up anyhow. And so we care so much about things. But things is not the purpose of God. Those are the blessings of God. You know, we don't even consider the blessings of God. The blessings that we're here, we're in our right mind. We came in a vehicle, we have a car, we have food. The third world countries don't have these things. There's Christians today that are being persecuted and killed for the cause of their testimony. And the Church of Jesus Christ at large is weak in its testimony, because its testimony is not sin and degradation and hellfire and repentance and sanctification. But that's what the kingdom of God is about. It's difficult to just go about your daily routines and not be nudged by the Holy Spirit about things that you shouldn't think. Places you shouldn't go, things that your eyes shouldn't see. You know that you should turn away. Sometimes we go, oh, man. You know, we want to get the detail. Just turn away. Because God is coming for a church. He's going to arm out the wrinkles. And we're the church. And so I say this lovingly and kind, that this is the Lenten season. The season where we can have a contrite, humble spirit and honor God with the discipline and take on something. Now, you'll do really good the first 3 days, you know, but the fourth day, you know, you'll have to make it up at the end. Am I telling the truth? I tell you, I've been 60 days doing it. But the point is, we're going to do it for the cause of God. Yes, because his eternal purpose is us. Everything he has done in this earth, that message that I preached a couple of 3 weeks ago when I talked about all the things that God has created in this atmosphere, in this world, the mountains, the trees, everything that he's created is all of his purpose to bless us. And we forget to even see those blessings because they raised our rent. You know, or the taxes are up. We go through these hard places. Those are our trials, our struggles. And we will be triumphant because he promised, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I mean, he didn't promise a fur coat, maybe, but he will leave us or he won't forsake us, and he will always be there for us in our struggles. So his desire is that we faint not at tribulation, amen. Because the tribulations, now hold on to your hat, the tribulations is our glory. How we come through the tribulations is our glory. He looks down and he says, well, they made it through that. I am glorified in them because they are still in church. They're still tithing. They're still faithful. They're still plugging on. And I'm glorified in them. It's important to Jesus. It's important to God. Well, in conclusion this morning, Isaiah 14, 26 and 27, this is really important. It says, this is the purpose. That is purpose upon the whole earth. And this is the hand that is outstretched upon all nations. Talking about God. The Lord of hosts has purpose. And who shall his knowledge? And his hand is stretched out, and who shall turn it back? Moses wanted to disannul the Israelites. Moses stood in the gap. And I'm sure that God has looked at this verse many times. We wanted to disannul it, but Jesus has stood in the gap. And when he looks at us and he sees our weaknesses and starts to think negative if God does such a thing, he sees the blood of Jesus. Every time he looks at us, he sees the shed blood of Jesus that covers us. And he cannot disannul his people because that's his eternal purpose. And church, you know, you look at your life sometimes and you know, you maybe have not done the things you want to do, or you don't have the things you want, or, you know, those kinds of things. And you go through those seasons. Everybody goes through those seasons. You evaluate things. John has more than you, or blah, 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 blah. Somebody has a better job. You go through those things, and you evaluate those things. But, you know, God has a purpose for right where you are. He has a purpose for what you're going through. And his purpose is not in this life. His purpose is eternal. So the final thought of this episode concerning Moses, you know, is that God wants to gather us all together. And he can do that through Christ. He couldn't get the Israelites together because they walked in disobedience. They could not keep the law. They could not keep the restrictions. Don't you just get tired at work sometimes, you people that still work? Don't you just get tired of all the legalities of things, and then they change things? I remember Phyllis used to say, I just got used to these instruments, and now they got new ones. And I fuss all the time, Jesus, forgive me, all the time about my computer because, you know, I got it just set just right, and then something new comes. But, you know, Jesus never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, forever. No matter how we change, no matter how our world changes, he's still the same. And his eternal purpose is you. And his eternal purpose is me. And I want you to think about that in this discipline season and in these things. And the final thought from Moses and the 12 spies is found in Numbers 14, 20 and 21. It says, the Lord said, I have pardoned as truly as I live. All the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Lord. So if you watch the news and you hear all the bad things, because that's all they talk about. I thought they were supposed to be for us, but obviously they're for the disagreements that they have. Just remember one thing, that all the world is going to be filled with the glory. Those things of this world will fade and pass away. And the eternal purpose of God is you, and you are going to live forever because God has purposed it through Jesus Christ. Be encouraged, saints. I don't know, maybe I just preached it to myself today. But we need to be encouraged because as the days are, so shall the wickedness be, but so shall the Lord be. And he will never leave us. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Father, we love you today. We worship you. We ask that you prepare our hearts for a Lenten discipline. That you speak to us and tell us what to take on. that will bring delight to your heart. We ask that you bless the offering today, the tithes of your people, the gifts. Bless your people and their faithfulness to your house today, I pray. And continue, Lord Jesus, to stir your word in our heart. Give you thanks, Lord.